Good morning, everyone. Welcome to worship on this Sunday after Easter as we continue to remind ourselves of the risen power of Jesus Christ and his gift of unconditional love. Welcome, one and all, as we gather in worship. For those of you in person, welcome. I invite you to make sure you have your bulletin, you have your prepackaged communion, so you have that all set. Yes, there are offering plates back there. For those of you who still bring your physical offering. And for those, and again, I welcome you and I thank you for wearing your masks and socially distancing yourselves from one another so that way we can continue together in this time. For those of you joining us online, welcome. I invite you to try to set aside the space a little bit. I recommend lighting candles like we do at the church to remind ourselves of God's presence and that challenge given to us in baptism to let your light so shine before others that they may see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven. If you're joining us for communion, I invite you to please have those communion elements handy as well. For all of us, as we gather here this day, and for those of you at home who can still come in if you'd like, there is a Red Cross blood drive that is happening right now next door in the conference room. And here you thought that the church was only after your money. We're after your blood too. Okay, no, we're not really after anything other than the ways in which we can respond to what God has gifted us with. And one of them is blood. We can't make blood any other way. And so if you can and you're able to, please, the Red Cross has slots up till, I think, about 1:30 this afternoon. There's some slots that are still available. Again, a reminder that one of the ongoing ministries of the church is the lot on 22nd Street. There is a ton of different kinds of things that we try to put together for food boxes and other items for the people who are in that neighborhood and for the homeless that are in that area. If you have any of those items you'd like to drop by, we have a big collection spot in the nursery, which is across the courtyard from the office that is open 9 to 3, Monday through Thursday, office hours. If you have items that you would like to bring by that those hours just don't work for you, let the office know, and we will be happy to make sure that someone can meet you and get you in. Also, again, if you're having any technical issues or missing emails at times, please notify the office so we can rectify it. We try various different ways of doing so. We'd just like to be able to make sure that you get connected and you pick up all these things because a lot of stuff is now sent electronically and we want to make sure you have it. And so as you have those items, you have, later on, I invite you to take a look at the grace notes that'll be coming out, speaking of things that are, emailed out. But now let us continue with worship. In the season of baptism, we continue to remind ourselves of the power of baptism and how Christ has called us. Alleluia! Christ is risen! Refreshed by the resurrection life we share in Christ, let us give thanks for the gift of baptism. We thank you, risen Christ, for these waters where you make us new, leading us from death to life, from tears to joy. We bless you, risen Christ, that your spirit comes to us in this grace-filled waters of rebirth, like rains that, to our thirsting earth, like streams that revive our souls, like cups of cold water given to strangers. Breathe your peace on your church when they hide in fear. Clothe us with your mercy and forgiveness. Send us companions and our journey that as we share your life. Make us one, risen Christ. Cleanse our hearts. Shower us with life. To you be given all praise in the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God, now and forever. Amen. He is risen. Alleluia. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Thank you.
Now the green blade rises from the buried grain. We eat that in dark earth many days has lain. Love lives again that with the dead has been. Love is come again like wheat arising green. In the grave they laid him, love by hatred slain, thinking that he would never wake again. Laid in the earth like grain that sleeps unseen, love is come again like wheat arising green. Forth he came at Easter like the risen grain. He that for 3 days in the grave had lain, raised from the dead, my living Lord is seen. Love is come again like wheat arising green. When our hearts are wintry, grieving or in pain, your touch can call us back to life again. Fields of our hearts that dead and bare have been, love is come again like wheat arising green.
The Lord be with you. Let us join our hearts in prayer. O God, you have prepared for those who love you joys beyond understanding. Pour into our hearts such love for you that, loving you above all things, we may obtain your promises, which exceed all we can desire. Through Jesus Christ, your Son and our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Our first reading today is from Acts 10. While Peter shares the good news of Jesus with the Gentile soldier and his family, the Holy Spirit comes upon them. Recognizing that the Spirit works inclusively in the lives of both Jews and Gentiles, Peter commands that these Gentiles also be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ. While Peter was still speaking, the Holy Spirit fell upon all who had heard the word. The circumcised believers who had come with Peter were astounded that the gift of the Holy Spirit had been poured out even on the Gentiles. For they heard them speaking in tongues and extolling God. Then Peter said, "Can anyone withhold the water for baptizing these people who have received the Holy Spirit just as we have?" So he ordered them to be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ. Then they invited him to stay for several days. Word of God, word of life. Our psalm today is Psalm 98. We'll read this responsibly. Sing a new song to the Lord, who has done marvelous things, whose right hand and holy arm have won the victory. You remember your steadfast love and faithfulness to the house of Israel. All the ends of the earth have seen the victory of our God. Sing to the Lord with the harp and the voice of song. Let the sea roar and all that fills it, the world and those who dwell therein. The Lord will judge the world with righteousness and the peoples with equity.
Our gospel for this Sunday of Easter comes to us from the gospel according to John. Glory to you, O Lord. Now, last week I added a couple verses at the end, so some of this will sound familiar, but then the story continues. Jesus is again teaching his disciples in the upper room during that Last Supper, what's known as the farewell discourse. As the Father has loved me, so I have loved you. Abide in my love. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I've kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. I have said these things to you so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete. This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. No one has greater love than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. You are my friends if you do what I command you. I do not call you servants any longer because the servant does not know what the master is doing. But I have called you friends because I have made known to you everything that I have heard from my Father. You did not choose me, but I chose you. And I appointed you to go and bear fruit, fruit that will last, so that the Father will give you whatever you ask in my name. I am giving you these commands so that you may love one another. The Gospel of our Lord. Please be seated. It's not an unusual thing, as one gets older, to start taking stock and to think about what has been done and what has been accomplished. You know, what would be written as an epitaph or an obituary? You know, one of the things, it's kind of sad. The inventor of the USB plug, you know, that wonderful plug that goes in our computers, recently passed away. The sad thing was when they were trying to lower the coffin into the ground, they had to stop, pull it back out, turn it around, and then put it down. Then again, also, I mean, it's been a rough year for many people. The founder of the Hokey Pokey Clinic died. You know, that's the place where you go to turn yourself around. The problem happened when they were actually trying to put him in the casket. First, they put the left foot in, and then chaos ensued. And then again, I know a lot of people are finding out that the funeral home costs are going up. They're blaming it on the cost of living. Shall we say that's a grave situation? I know. But how often do we, around the times of death, around the times of later in life, do we stop and we think about what we accomplished, what we didn't accomplish, the things we did and the things we left undone? Oftentimes it's simple, where we kind of just think back of, well, how did I get here? I'm a child of the 80s, the Talking Heads, well, how did I get here from that song? And you just ask yourself, well, how did I get here? And I've asked this question before for all of you to think of, how did you get here? None of you were there with Jesus in that upper room. None of you saw his resurrected body. Somehow this story got to you. Somewhere you got to be a part of the vine that Jesus talked about. Now, some people ask me, okay, Pastor, we've known a few other pastors in our time, and you're a little different. When they're kind, they use the word little. And I guess it's important to share the fact of how I got in. Yes, I am a cradle Lutheran. I was baptized in a Lutheran church. In fact, I was baptized in a national historical monument, the oldest Danish Lutheran church on the mainland, in the same font my grandfather was. Because of that, I got to meet the Queen of Denmark when she came for the 1976 bicentennial. I was like this tall, and I saw her, and that's about it, okay? But woohoo, I know royalty. I'm also the oldest of three sons. In a time in the church when children are not supposed to be heard and barely seen. Many of you might remember that time when you were supposed to wear suits. Or ladies, you were supposed to wear dresses. And it didn't matter how comfortable or not it was. You were to be in your Sunday best, as if you were trying to impress God. Or were you trying to impress the other people? All right. Add in a father who worked very hard and often on Sundays, and a mom trying to corral three boys in the back pew, because that's all where they put us, when we can't see a bloody thing and try to be quiet. One of my most powerful memories growing up of church was footed pajamas, candlelight, Christmas Eve. Lovely. Once a year. Most of the rest of the time, if we made it to church, it was what we refer to as the look. Like, why are you disturbing my worship, you little child? If you notice, I have very little patience for anyone who does that to any child in worship. I learned. Now, as life progressed, as things became a little easier, I went to church a little bit more. I became a Sunday school student in fifth grade. And for the Christmas pageant, my class, Mrs. Block's fifth grade class, and Mrs. Block taught Moses the commandments, we were assigned to provide the wise men, and me, Dave and Tony were assigned to do it, and we became known as Mrs. Block's wise guys because you put 10-year-old boys in goofy robes and tell them to not act out. There you go. She warned us. God will get you. A couple years later, we left that church, and the next time I saw Dave was at orientation at seminary. Don't know what happened to Tony, but 2/3 ain't bad. But in order to get there, I had to get over a few things. I had to learn a number of different things because somehow I got a couple of images in my head. One is that pastors are perfect and have it all together. Their feet maybe touch the ground. Everything's just so. They're holy. Yeah. The other thing is that God is really this mean-looking dude on a cloud looking for a reason to smite me. That somehow God looks a lot like Charlton Heston from the Ten Commandments, and he's not happy. He's distant and mad. You know what you do with someone who's distant and mad? You stay away from them. So I had to learn. How did I learn? There's a long story there, but I won't give it to you. It's called the birth of my son, who completely derailed all the plans that my wife and I had placed, because we were going to go off to get our advanced degrees. I was a history teacher first, taught government history. I was going to go get a doctorate in history. Be an even larger font of useless information than I was before. And Zach came along and was born the day we would have started classes. Yeah, that didn't work. But as Zach was born, for those of you who've held a brand new newborn, I'm not talking after the cleanup. I'm talking about a brand new newborn. All of the pretty, cute, and adorable is not there. It's multicolored and slimy and screaming. But for God so loved the world, he gave his only son. This angry bearded dude on a cloud became this mess in my hand. God wasn't about distance and anger. It was about nearness and love. I had to learn. I don't know where I learned the angry God on a cloud image, but I'm sure in talking to many people, that's pretty common. Somehow society teaches us, in a Christian society that supposedly follows Jesus Christ, that God's really looking to zap you for some reason if you do the wrong thing or you don't do enough of the right thing. I had to learn. I had to come to that point. And even when I was wrestling with seminary, I'll never forget Pastor Randy Weinkoff, who was our pastor at that time, and you know, he baptized Zach, and I did a lot of talking with him. And I remember in the Lenten series, he talked about the raw materials of Lent, where he talked about the tree in the forest that became the cross, and the bramble that was ripped up out of the hedgerows that was used for the crown of thorns, and the cotton that became the robe, and things like that. And he talked about the iron that came in, that made into the nails. And the point he made, pun intended, was how many times did God have to hit you on the head to get your attention? It's a darn good thing that followers of Jesus Christ are really called disciples, which in the Acts Bible study, we got to the point where the Christians were, where they first got the name Christians. And one of the translation was learnerians. We normally translate it as student, but student is so passive. A learnerian. And we're supposed to learn, we're supposed to grow, which ties very nicely into this whole image of the vine, because let's face it, life is about growth. You know something is alive if it grows. How do we grow? How do we learn? I had to learn about a God who was not this angry dude. I had to learn about a God who is loving and near and willing to take on our stuff, not just smack us for as we try to deal with our stuff. Now, as I look and you go through the Bible, I see all of these people. One of them is Peter. You hear about Peter in the first lesson. If you did not follow the instructions in the email to read more of the book of Acts, well, good news, you're forgiven. But I invite you to do so, because Peter, remember, Peter's called the rock. Right? How often was Peter the rockhead, though? And if you read that section I told you to, which is basically the second half of chapter 9 and through 10, you get to the point where Peter can say the things he did, and it didn't come easy. Even he had to learn. He had to have a vision of a God that said, "Don't you dare call profane what I have made clean." He was able to go into the house of a centurion, a Gentile, and not just a Gentile, but a Gentile officer of the occupying army of his land, and start his presentation off with, "Now I know that God shows no partiality." What? One of the chosen ones who wouldn't dare enter the house of a Gentile, much less speak to them or associate with them in any way whatsoever, is in the house of a Gentile occupying officer, and he says, "Now I know that God shows no partiality." And God put a big exclamation point at the end of it when he said, when you heard the lesson where it said that as Peter was speaking, the Holy Spirit fell on them all. Who can withhold the water for baptism? And he baptized entire household. Yes, that means Gentiles and Jews, male and old and young. God shows no partiality, and Peter had to get hit on the head repeatedly to get there. If you keep reading the book of Acts, you'll realize he still needs to get smacked upside the head from time to time. Just like us. Because how often do we still want to draw lines and make distinctions? How often do we still struggle with some of the things that we might have been taught somewhat passively, sometimes very assertively, that places others opposite us? That teaches us that there is supposed to be partiality. Jesus tells us to love. This is his command. All the commandments. This is how we show that we are abiding in that love. But think about that love that has to be there to lead to growth, because loving doesn't just mean loving the people who love you back. Jesus was very clear on the fact, if you love those who love you back, what good is that? No. He then goes them further and says, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you. Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. He took all 613 commandments of the Old Testament and rolled it down into one. You will love one another. That's how you will show that you are my learner in, if you have love for one another. But think about how much that takes to learn to love one another. In fact, sometimes the more you know about someone else, the less you want to love them. But maybe that's why, if you want to think about, if there's one big message from the cross, it's the fact that he went that far to love you. Because you were worth it. Your life was worth the life of the Son of God because of the love of God. For God so loved the world, he gave his Son. And that vine comes out, that gift of life comes. And again, think back to what had to happen for you to come and be a part of a life of faith today. Very few people remain who do so out of a motivation of fear. Love goes and grows. Love comes and makes new. Hate destroys. Love creates. And Jesus calls us to be a part of this life, this new life, this life that is being created, this life that is rooted in the love of God for us and for the world. And yes, God will be there when you need to get hit on the head. But that God will also be the one who will carry you and carry you forward. The clerical I'm wearing is one of the Linda Clausen originals. It has the sand and the footprints on it. And we're familiar with the footprints, you know, poem about how life was going along and the person was looking back on their life and they saw two sets of footprints. And then they said, but wait a minute, I only see one set of footprints. Is that when you abandoned me, God? No, that's when I carried you. But also, if we look back, we'll probably see those times when one wanders off and then the other pair goes and gets. You will also find those ones that look like you are dancing. You will also find long ruts. For that is where God had to drag you. But God does so out of love. And may we learn in love. May we be learner-ians and learn this gift of love, this gift of grace. so that we can go and grow in love for one another, for our neighbors as ourselves, as we grow in loving the Lord our God, who gives us the love to start with. So remember, God loves you, and so do I. Amen. Now, as we go forth from this point, I didn't see the Holy Spirit fall on you yet, but we believe in holy baptism that we receive this gift. And so I invite you to remember the promises God gave you in holy baptism. And we'll see where this goes. If you repeat after me, I've been sealed by the Holy Spirit. I've been marked with the cross of Christ forever. I am Christ's. Amen. I invite you to join me in confessing the faith of the Church through the words of the Apostles' Creed, our baptismal creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. We lift up the prayers of the people that have been submitted in various ways. There was a couple that came in, one who's facing cancer, and we'll add him to the cancer list, and one who died of COVID just this past. And so as we prepare our hearts for prayer, O Lord, hear our prayer.
Let my prayer rise up like incense before you, the lifting up of my hands as an offering to you.
For all of those needing health and healing, especially Jeannie, Cindy, Pete, Brenda, Linda, Betsy, Ron, Olivia, Anne, Sherry, Doug, Mary, Emily, Barbara, Vi, Lissa, Maria, Ryan, Jerry, Diane, Lynn, Jasmine, Sarah, and Rita. O Lord, hear our prayer.
Let my prayer rise up like incense before you, the lifting up of my hands as an offering to you.
For all those dealing with cancer, especially Nils, JR, Heidi, Troy, George, Susan, Barb, Jim, and Sherry. Lord, hear our prayer.
Let my prayer rise up like incense before you, the lifting up of my hands as an offering to
for all first responders, healthcare workers, those who care for others, especially the most vulnerable in our population. We pray especially for Heather, Christine, Greg, Darren, Allison, Cara, Aaron, Rihanna, Betsy, Matthew, Jennifer, PJ, Randy, Emma, Lindsay, Samantha, Colin, Michelle, Erica, Mike, Aaron, Nancy, Linda, Susan, Rachel, Mark, Sarah, Joe, and Josh. O Lord, hear our prayer.
Let my prayer rise up like incense before you, the lifting up of my hands as an offering to
for all of those who mourn, especially the family and friends of Terence DeCouris, who passed away of COVID this past week, Ernesto Felix, Barbara Wagner, Paul Coleridge, Juan Acala, David Mangus Sr., Paul Behrens, George Nulf. All those who mourn the almost 580,000 who have died of COVID in the U.S., over 3.25 million worldwide, especially for all of the suffering that is currently in India and other places of the world where it is running rampant. Oh Lord, hear our prayer.
Let my prayer rise up like incense before you, the lifting up of my hands as an offering to you.
For all those who are facing tragedies near and far, man-made and natural, big and small, and prayers especially for those who seek to help, to recover, to restore, to rebuild. For those facing housing, food, healthcare, and financial insecurities, securing jobs that pay enough, and for those concerns that they may have about possible exposure to themselves or those they live with and care for. Families in crisis and those feeling alone and isolated, and the situation is not helping. For a quick and safe distribution of vaccines, for care, compassion, justice, and mercy and peace for all. For those who are known only to God, that are in our hearts right now. On this day, we pray for all moms, all the moms out there. And a mom is not someone who gives birth. In fact, moms do not necessarily have a gender sometimes. It is those who care. We pray especially for all moms who mourn the loss of a child, for all moms struggling with fertility issues of their own, for all the children who mourn the loss of their moms. May this day be a day of remembering, nurturing, and love as part of the vine and the command of love. O Lord, hear our prayer.
Let my prayer rise up like incense before you, the lifting up of my hands as an offering to you.
But fundamentally, we give thanks. We give thanks for the gift of life, for the gift of love, for the gift of love that comes to us and keeps going and keeps growing. For the sounds of life that we hear because we have our doors open and you can hear the birds. And a reminder that if God can care for the sparrow, God cares for us as well. For the gift of love and for the gift of moms in however form they may take. For that gift of nurture and love. We give thanks for all of those who are giving blood to the Red Cross, for all the donations came in for the lot and come in for interfaith community services, and all of the other ways in which we show that love of God that we have received. We give thanks for the improved health of baby Roland, who is actually improving. And we just give thanks for life. So we celebrate the birthdays of Jay Sundberg, Judy Gonzalez, Susanna MacArthur, Justin Templin, and the anniversaries of Lynn and Kevin Nalen, Janine and Ted Norris, Bethany and Justin Templin, and Kathy and James Lippard. And all of the other signs of life that we are a part of, all those other ways in which we were reminded of how connected we are to one another and the gift of grace and love and mercy that we see and that we can share. May we celebrate it. May we give thanks. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. The peace of the risen Christ be with you all. Please. Please, again, find some ways as we go forward in life to be a person of peace, not just in here or at home or at work, at play. Be that person of peace to a world in need. And for those of you in the space, we'd be passing offering plates. Well, not yet. That gets a little too close. But there are offering plates in the back, for special offering, for the offerings. If you have it, we still receive mail and all that kind of stuff. Support your local post office. There's also electronic giving options. They're on the website. And again, a reminder that, there are still leftovers of the youth group's Easter breakfast because they can't go bad. They were keto friendly, carb friendly, calorie friendly because they didn't have one. But it's a big fundraiser for them to get ready for the National Youth Gathering, which is happening next year. So there's a special tag on the electronic giving if you want to give directly that way, or you can dedicate money so that they can go next year too. As it is, it's supposedly in Minnesota. So they're going to the Lutheran Holy Land. So they need to make sure they bring their casseroles and their bunt, dishes full of Jello. Actually, they should bring some good fajitas and everything else like that, show them what real food is like. Let us pray. God of love, you call us beloved children and welcome us to your table. Receive our lives and the gifts we offer. Abide with us and send us in service to a suffering world for the sake of your beloved child, Jesus Christ. Amen. Now is the time to set the table. So last call, we'd flicker the lights in here, but that'd be a little silly. If you haven't picked up your prepackaged communion, for those of you here, please go grab that now. For those of you at home and joining us for communion, simple plate, simple cup, wine, grape juice, something simple, bread, crackers, something simple. Jesus pulled the simple staple items off of a banquet table to remind us of what God can do with the basic and the simple, because it was supposed to be a reminder that God is with us always, on the big days and on the little days, because it's always. And so if you have those items prepared, then let us continue. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Let us gathered around the throne of grace, we proclaim, holy, holy, holy Lord, Lord God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. We cry out Hosanna to the Lord as we welcome the Lord once more into our lives. We cry Hosanna to the Lord as we welcome once more this, this fulfillment of prophecy, this one that came to proclaim the nearness of the kingdom of God. We come to this time when we remember we gather with this, our Lord and Savior, in that upper room as he sought to teach us, as we receive these learnings from those who came before us and who showed us love and brought to life our Lord and Savior into our midst. And so we remember in which our Savior was betrayed. He took bread, he blessed it and broke it, gave it for us to eat and said, take and eat all of you. This is my body. It's broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And after supper, he took the cup. After giving thanks, he gave it for all to drink, saying, take and drink. This cup contains the blood of the new covenant, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me. So So may we receive this gift of life, this gift of love, this gift of love that comes to us and gives us the gift of new life. And by the power of your Holy Spirit, may we be filled by this Spirit and go forth proclaiming Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen. Remember us in your kingdom, dear Lord, and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The risen Christ invites us to this table. Come, eat, and be satisfied. For those of you gathered in this space, I invite you to be very careful as you take the cellophane off so you don't end up with a wafer. Or as you pull, you don't end up taking the foil off and ending up with the grape juice a little faster than you expected. And also be careful you don't squeeze too hard when you pull it. Otherwise, you end up with a fountain of grape juice. For those of you online, if you have someone who is there, you can take turns giving and receiving. Please do so. Otherwise, if you're feeling like you're all alone, remember, you're not. It's the gathering of the body of Christ, the communion of saints. We are all in this together. And so may we all receive the body of Christ broken for you, the blood of Christ shed for you. Take and eat, take and drink, these gifts of God given for you.
Shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. Bear my cross. You laid down your life that I would be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Nations with truth and justice shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love that you would take my place. You would bear my cross. You laid down your life that I would be set free.
entered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain.
Worthy,
worthy, worthy. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross.
Thank you for coming in and singing. And that's part of the reason, you know, as we go forward, you know, strong encouragement for people to, you know, be good, behave, you know, wear your mask, get your vaccines. I mean, do more and more things. Thank you, Testify, for coming in, reminding us what we have to sing for. Thank you. The body and blood of our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ, strengthen us and keep us in his grace. Amen. Wellspring of joy, through this meal you have put gladness in our hearts. Satisfy the hunger still around us and send us as joyful witnesses that your love may bring joy to the hearts of all people through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. May our glorious God grant you a spirit of wisdom to know and to love the risen Lord Jesus, the God of life. Father and Son, Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever. Amen. Now is a dismissal, and then you know we have a postlude from Becky. So, if you know, for those of you who are gathered in space, if you'd like to, you know, gather and help out, you know, to gather and have some time to chat out in the courtyard, you're more than welcome to. If we can twist some of your arms to help carry some of the stuff over to Werner Hall so we can set up for the 10 o'clock, I would greatly appreciate it, since there's a, you know, few things we need to get over there for that one. But as we go forth, alleluia, Christ is risen. Go in peace. Share the good news. Alleluia.